email was unheard of 100 years ago, yet now everyone uses it. Well, will digital money fall into that same category? Bitcoin is a digital currency that has many supporters and many skeptics. And here to explain it all is Gavin Andreessen, Chief Scientist of the Bitcoin Foundation, and Jesse Vanek, founder of the Western Mass BTC. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for explaining this to us. And I will be the first one to admit that I don't have a clue about Bitcoin and how digital currency works. And that's why you guys are here, to explain it all for us and break it down for us on very simple terms. So we'll start with you, Jesse. What is Bitcoin? It's digital money. How do you explain that to somebody?
Well, I'm very glad that Gavin is here, that perhaps he can help explain some of the more technical aspects of it. But at its core, it's a new technology that is essentially digital money. And so it allows you to exchange value with another person or another business through the internet in nearly an instant and from across the globe.
Very, very similar to email. And you would have never thought how many years ago, you can immediately correspond with somebody, and yet now you can do that, and that's kind of how it is with Bitcoin. How did you get involved? How did you hear about it?
Yeah, I heard about Bitcoin purely by accident. I was actually kind of looking around for something to do in 2010. I'm a computer programmer. I'd gotten back from a sabbatical in Australia, actually. We'd spent 6 months there, and was kind of looking around for something interesting to keep me busy. And I stumbled across the Bitcoin open source software project, which at that time in 2010 was about a year old. And pretty much nobody except for a few computer geeks had heard about it. So I got involved pretty early and just kind of got sucked in deeper and deeper until I became the lead programmer for that open source software project and chief scientist of the Bitcoin Foundation.
So when somebody asks you what you do and you try to explain this to them, how do you do it without them kind of looking at you saying, huh, what are you talking about?
Well, I mean, it's an odd idea that you can have a kind of money that's defined by a software program running on the internet. So it is a brand new kind of money. I think it makes us really think about what is money, what makes a money useful and good, which is basically, you know, can you buy things with it? You know, is it possible to trade with it? I had a fantastic experience just a few weeks ago. I was actually in New Zealand. We went to Australia for another sabbatical and stopped by in New Zealand on our way back, and actually went on a rafting trip down this fantastic, beautiful river in New Zealand. And while we were eating lunch, just struck up a conversation with our guide, who was a 60-something-year-old New Zealand river guide, nicknamed Finn for Huckleberry Finn. And he mentioned Bitcoin to me, which was odd because I had never mentioned that I had anything to do with Bitcoin. But, you know, down in New Zealand, this old-time river guide had heard of it, and we got into a great conversation about money and banking and, you know, why he was interested in Bitcoin. And I ended up paying for that trip using Bitcoin. You know, he was perfectly happy to accept it as payment for his services. I was very happy to, you know, pay it to him for that fantastic trip. And it just kind of shows you that it really is taking off all over the world.
And Gavin's been involved with it for a couple of years. Jesse, you're kind of newer to the scene than Gavin. What sparked your interest? What
sure. Got you interested? Well, I've long been interested in things like emerging technologies and online privacy and alternative currencies and even local currencies like Berkshares and Ithaca Hours. And so it was December 2012, and I was reading something online along those lines and saw a reference to Bitcoin and became intrigued by it and figured out how to buy a couple of Bitcoin and then learned how to trade them on the exchanges and spend them and donate them and keep them secure. And while I didn't jump in with both feet right away, it was very shortly after that it just sort of kicked off as a year-long, shall we say, an obsession with learning all things Bitcoin.
So. Okay. Now, why does Bitcoin matter? Why should people care about it?
Well, I mean, the vision for Bitcoin is to become the currency of the internet. If you think about email, as you brought up, email is a fantastic example. Before we had email, you know, every country had their own postal system. If you wanted to send, if you want to communicate with somebody overseas, you know, you'd write them a letter, you'd put a stamp on it, it would go through your local, you know, your national postal system, then get on some airplane and go to some other national postal system, and eventually, many days later, sometimes many weeks later, sometimes never, you know, your letter would show up and you'd be able to communicate with them. The internet changed all that, right? I mean, if you want to communicate with somebody overseas, you just send them an email. It happens pretty much instantly. Right. You know, the email gets there within seconds, usually. If you think about money, I mean, money today is in the same state that kind of the postal systems were, where, you know, every country has their own money, or in the case of like the euro, right, each region has its own money. If you've ever tried to send money overseas, it's incredibly expensive and slow, and it can be incredibly frustrating. Bitcoin really is designed as kind of a money system for the internet, so that it's just as easy to pay somebody Bitcoin who lives in New Zealand as it is to pay somebody who lives right next door to you. So it's really designed to be more efficient, quicker, and just overall kind of a modern money system designed using the technology that we have available today.
Now, there are some skeptics out there, and I'm kind of going off what Gavin just said. What about somebody who says, yeah, but Bitcoin may be easier, but what is it backed by? If somebody is concerned, like, okay, well, what does it mean?
Well, the sort of off-the-cuff response to that is, what is the U.S. dollar backed by? And I'll answer that question in a little more depth and not just leave it there, because some would say that the U.S. dollar is backed by the United States government, the full faith of the U.S. government. Bitcoin has real utility. If you think about it, what would the price be? If you could put a price on it, what would you put the price at for email? What is that worth? And so ultimately, at some point, this is a utility that will enable the transfer of money from one location to another nearly instantly. You'll be able to travel around the world and not have to exchange into local currencies. And all of that has a real value to it. And so instead of being backed by a physical product like gold, or maybe the way the dollar used to be, mm-hmm, it's backed by utility and by service. How to price that is a complicated question, and that's something that's still sort of being ironed out as we see price fluctuations in Bitcoin happening pretty often, although less so recently. But I believe that there is real utility in it, and that that's what backs Bitcoin.
People need to trust Bitcoin to really make it work.
Trust is huge. I mean, you know, when I first got involved with Bitcoin, I didn't trust it. You know, I have the technical capability to kind of look at the code, look at how it actually works, think really hard about, you know, can you break it? Could you forge Bitcoins? Could you steal somebody's Bitcoins? And to really understand how it works. And that's how I came to trust Bitcoin. You know, I didn't trust it on faith. I trusted it because I could actually look at it and really understand it deeply, how it works. As time has gone on, and more people like me who actually have the ability to look at it and think about it and try to break it, mm-hmm, and have come out and said, you know, the fundamental technology is solid, we're starting to build up more and more trust. And so people are trusting that, you know, if a few dozen security experts say, you know, the core of Bitcoin is secure, then it starts to gain more trust by people who you maybe don't have they're not computer geeks. Mm-hmm. As we see a couple big online retailers, Overstock.com and Tiger Direct, just in the last week announced that you can pay Bitcoin for their products. So, you know, you start to trust that if you have some Bitcoins, well, there's stuff you can spend them on. And, you know, these big companies aren't stupid, so you start to assume that there must be something there. There must be, you know, a good reason why these big companies are trusting this wacky, crazy, right, internet experiment.
That's turning into something, it seems. Now, what about the potential for abuse, though? I mean, it's got to be a concern.
It is. It is a concern. And in fact, there's been hearings just recently in New York State about whether to regulate Bitcoin, and if so, how it should be regulated. And I expect that those conversations are going to continue to happen. But what I always come back to is that there aren't any abuses that I am aware of that can take place with Bitcoin that aren't already ongoing to far greater extent with cash. Regardless of whatever crime or money laundering or anything along those lines, cash is king. U.S. dollars are the go-to, and so Bitcoin is in no worse a situation, and in fact, there are properties of it that make it less susceptible to abuse. For example, it can't be counterfeited, and because of the way the protocol is structured, transactions can, in fact, be traced to a certain degree, and so there are some uses in law enforcement for analyzing transactions that make it more desirable than cash to prevent nefarious activities. And so while, yes, there are potential opportunities for abuse, I believe that the potential advancements in technology and the positive attributes that it will bring about far outweigh any potential abuse.
This is probably a good place for me to inject my standard public service announcement, which is Bitcoin's still an experiment, and it's still really cutting-edge technology. And so for ordinary people, you know, I still tell people, don't invest your life savings in Bitcoin. Only invest time or money that you can afford to lose. Because there are a lot of hackers out there. Computer security is a whole other topic that I could spend a couple hours talking about, the poor, sorry state of computer security. And you know, part of my job as the lead developer for Bitcoin is to try to make it, you know, easy enough to use that I could actually, you know, trust my mom with some Bitcoins, which I don't at this point. I love my mom. She's not technical. If I gave her some Bitcoins, I'd really be worried that she would just lose them. Mm. So, you know, it's a really interesting new technology. I think you can think of it like, you know, a really interesting internet startup that, you know, everybody's excited about and, you know, may take over the world.
I was just gonna say, where do you see it going in the future? Is it going to take over the world?
A lot of people, a lot of really smart people think that either Bitcoin or something very much like Bitcoin will eventually replace the monies that we're using now. That, I mean, we're such a globally connected world that it makes sense to have a global currency, you know. And if you think about it, if you're the leader of some country that's not the United States, you know, you probably don't want the U.S. dollar to be the global currency. Mm. Every single country will not want, you know, any other country to be able to control their currency. It's just, you know, it's not acceptable. Right. And Bitcoin is really interesting because it's the first currency that's electronic and distributed. So there is no single company or person or government in control, right? It's everybody using Bitcoin is kind of in control of what happens with Bitcoin.
And that uncertainty, I guess, could either be a really good thing or a really bad thing, but it seems like it's shaping up to be a good thing with Bitcoin. So Gavin Andreessen and Jesse Vanek, thank you so much, both of you, for your time.
Thanks, it was a pleasure.
Thank you.